සම්මා සම්බුද්ධ සරණයි. සබ්බ පාපස්ස අකරණම් කුසලස්ස උපසම්පදා සචිත්ත පරියෝ දපනම් ඒතම් බුද්ධාන සාසනං. To not to do evil, to cultivate good and to purify one's mind. This is the message of all Buddhas. A very good evening to you and warm welcome to Dhamma and You. And today we have a very important guest who is going to speak about the practice of this path that Lord Buddha has taught us for eternal peace, for eternal bliss, Nirvana. And I would like to mostly reverently welcome Acharya Reverend Kema Sasanadipika, who has studied Buddhism for over 15 years and has been nun since the year 2006. And she's also the chairperson for the United International Buddha Dhamma Society and the co-founder of the Dhamma Sukha Meditation Center in Annapolis in Missouri in the United States of America. And I would like to once again give a warm welcome to you. Okay. And we're talking about the practice of Buddhism, Reverend Kema. I would like to ask you, what's different about this new approach to the Buddhist studies as well as to meditation?
Well, I think first what we have to look at is the tradition that my teacher has started in the United States. And he is a Mahatera monk, and he is an American teacher. It's the most venerable Bhante Vimala Ramsey Mahatera. And what he made a decision to do a number of years back was to start a new school of Buddhism, which would be totally dedicated to research, practice, the preservation, and the teaching of the early Buddhist texts. And the attempt was to actually ask several questions. And I think that that is what I'm most interested in. By going back to the texts, we don't dismiss, for instance, the commentarial works. We only put them in the position of reference, and then we accept guidance from the commentaries where it applies in agreement with the text. This is number one. And then number two is that Venerable was asking several questions, and when I got involved with him back in 2000, they were the same questions I was asking. And so I think a lot of us want to understand, what did the Buddha actually do, and how did he do it, and are the instructions still available, and can you do it too? That was how we started out in our work relationship, as far when I was a lay person, and that's what we became involved in.
All right, so Reverend Kim, I'd like to ask you, why don't we take a look at what the Lord Buddha really did to help us today, especially the society that is present in the present day world?
It's really important to look at that. It's really good, Vadima, because what I feel that he really found was a doorway to peace. Mm-hmm. He taught for 45 years during the time that he refined the primary subject that he was interested in. And it's interesting because he only had one job in his whole lifetime, which we'll probably mention again later. But he actually was a meditation teacher, and he was a master meditation teacher. But when you think of him as someone who taught the same subject for 45 years, he definitely became an expert on what he was researching. So what was it that he was teaching? Was he was actually looking to shift a person from reaction into response. So he was teaching the people a form of personal behavior management or behavioral modification that they could use, and they could probably learn very simply, and they could teach others. And I think when I talked to you the first time we were talking about this, I mentioned to you that at the time, the golden age of the Buddha, the figures are said to be about 60 million people were following the Buddha. Okay. And when we look at the breakdown of this, only about 4% of the people, about 4%, became monastics. And then when we look again, we say, how many of them actually became very strong meditators? And that was only 1%. So what my question was, as I became involved with this, really was, what were the other people doing? Why?
That's a very interesting question.
No. And I haven't seen very much written about it, but I think it's really interesting to consider 60 million people. What were they getting out of this training that was being taught? What were they getting from this teaching that they would make a decision that they would support the Buddha? Mm-hmm. And that they would support the monastics all the way until today, 2,600 years later, almost 2,600 years.
And also I want to ask you, adding to what you said, how did Lord Buddha really teach this Dhamma to the people? I think that's an important thing that we should highlight here.
Well, it starts by you have to have a foundation of understanding. And when he was still a bodhisattva, before he was enlightened, there is one sutta called Two Kinds of Thoughts, and this is taught from that perspective. Oh. He starts out by saying, monks, before I was enlightened, when I was still a bodhisattva, I sort of looked at the world and I wanted to understand, is it better for me to live with unwholesome thoughts? Mm-hmm. Or is it better for me to live with wholesome thoughts? So he starts an investigation, and he uses the steps of the Four Noble Truths to look at the problem, mm-hmm. and to figure out the cause gradually. And the first thing he discovers is that it's much better for me to live with wholesome thoughts, yes. and a wholesome lifestyle, mm-hmm. and it's better for me and everyone around me. And so he decides to practice following this direction. And because he had less distractions come back to him, this is what he did.
And also, I would like to ask you, Reverend Kemar, now in the present day society, people really look at a tool that really they can really use to practice or perhaps start practicing. Is this where the precepts come into play?
The precepts did come into play in reference to this. One of the things is you look at Lord Buddha, and he's doing this research for 6 years,
yes.
Or 6.5 years, I think it was, before he is finally totally awakened under the Bodhi tree. And during this time, he is attempting to figure all this out, and he comes out and he declares these precepts. And in the beginning, there were actually four. Mm-hmm. There weren't five. I was going to tell you that, too. And so we have these precepts that came up, but the precepts were not like commandments coming down from a deity or a godhead. These were precepts that he had tested. These were guidelines for successful living, for being happy, and having everything run smoothly. So this is where it kind of gets fun, because I was confronted a few years ago with a situation where there were a lot of young people in the room, and I thought there were only going to be a lot of adults there at this talk where I was going. There were like 40 people there, and there were a lot of college people were there, and they didn't want to hear me talk about morality, and I knew this, and the grandmother whose birthday it was had asked me to talk about morality. So I'm on the spot, and I have to come up with a way to explain these precepts, and what am I going to do, you know? But first, let's look at the precepts, okay? Because first, we have to take a look at these five guidelines that make a lot of sense. So the first thing he says are don't kill or harm living beings on purpose. He's saying this isn't a good idea. Don't kill any living beings on purpose. The second one he's saying is don't take anything that is not freely given. So don't steal anything. The third one is don't participate in wrong sexual activity. Now, this is refined. It's very clear in the Digha Nikaya, and there's a couple places in the Majjhima Nikaya where it makes a very clear breakdown of this. Don't have sexual activity with somebody who's too young, that's staying at home with their parents. Don't have sexual activity of any kind with somebody who doesn't want to participate. But the bottom line here is don't do anything that is going to cause physical or mental harm for you, the partner, or anybody else surrounding them. This means the parents, the grandparents, the people involved. Don't do that. It's going to cause a problem later. And then the next one is don't tell lies, use harsh speech, gossip, or slander. And then the last one is added later on in the story. This is added on. And when they add this one on, it's don't use recreational drugs or alcohol. Why? Because it clouds your mind and it's going to open the way for you to break these other precepts. So don't do that.
And can you tell me what is really meant by gossip and slander and how it can really affect the society? We've seen with the busy lab schedules that people go through, because of this term gossip, there are so much of problems that people go through and so much of situations that people have to overcome. Can you talk about it?
Well, it's good to ask about gossip and slander, because what we discovered was a lot of students don't really understand what gossip is and they don't understand slander. So I think it's important, it should be included in the precepts when we talk about it, because there are two danger points. So the first one is gossip, and if I'm talking to you about someone, someone told me something and I decide to talk to you about it, but I don't even know if it's true, and you're not here and you can't defend yourself, it's hurting someone very often in a bad way, and lots of people are hearing something we don't even know if it's true. So you don't want this to happen to you, and you don't want this to happen to the other people. You don't want that to happen. Okay, and then the other one is slander, and slander is an interesting word because people don't think about it a lot today, but slander simply means that I talk to you about someone else with the intention of making it so you won't work with that other person. So slander is about dividing people.
And this can cause a lot of trouble.
Yes, it can cause a lot of trouble. And we see this happening now in the news. We see this happening with one group who is upset, and they may have a march or a protest, and somebody comes from outside and comes in to play the game of slandering people against each other, and then it causes a bigger riot and things like this. You have to really watch for this. You can see slander happening if you watch very carefully. Yeah.
So, Reverend Kema, why do you think it is important for me to keep these precepts with me, as in practice it always, every single moment of my life, while I do all my day-to-day activities?
Well, if you don't, there's another side to the scale. Okay, and the other side is, their name is the Nivarana, or the hindrances. Mm-hmm. So the Buddha was not just telling you one side of the story.
Yes.
He was actually telling you both sides of the scale. He was saying, if we follow this side, the principle is that these precepts will make everything run smoothly. But if we break the precepts, then all of a sudden this scale comes down like this. And now the hindrances come knocking at the door. Mm-hmm. And these hindrances are visitors that come. And traditionally, from some influences of some of the commentaries, people like to fight with them and try to make them go away and make them stop. But there's another side to these hindrances. They're actually teachers. So they're coming to show you what it is that you're attached to, what it is that's irritating you. So we actually can learn from them. So my advice is, give them some tea and let them sit in the other room. Don't chat with them. Don't embrace them. Don't try to push them around. But let's see who they are first.
Of course, yes. I think that's a good way that we can approach these obstacles that hinder our minds. I'd like to ask you, who are these visitors? Why don't we elaborate on that?
Well, when I'm teaching Sunday school, I have a lot of fun with mm-hmm. this, because one of them is Mr. Lust and mm-hmm. N-Greed. Lust and greed.
Okay.
And the second visitor is Mr. Hatred and Aversion. Mm-hmm. And then we have the third one, who is Sloth and Torpor. But he's nicknamed as Dull Mind. Mm-hmm. He's the one that makes you sleepy at work and you don't want mm-hmm. to do something. You're getting really tired all of the time. And then the fourth one is Uncle Restlessness. And restlessness has some friends: restlessness, guilt, and remorse. And if these things start to bother you, then obviously something's wrong. You've broken a precept somewhere, and you need to check on that, and you need to straighten it out. And the fifth one is named Cousin Doubt. And doubt is a funny thing. What is doubt is just meaning I'm doubting the way that I'm doing the practice, or I'm doubting that I'm doing my job right. We get caught and consumed in doubt. So when they come to visit, you can make them feel pretty, they can make you feel pretty uncomfortable, yes. But you don't need to be mean to them. Mm-hmm. You can just let them go and relax, which is somewhat about this practice that mm-hmm. I want to show you.
And yeah. Which means what you say is we need to observe our mind very carefully while practicing the precepts, is it? In order to make sure that these hindrances will not hinder the yeah. path that we take.
One of the things that happens is that you watch your mind's, the movement of your mind's attention. Mm-hmm. And why do you do that? Because the Buddha made a statement that what you think and ponder on, that is the inclination of your mind. That's the direction you're going to mm-hmm. go to. He made a statement that mind is the forerunner of all states. Mm-hmm. And so if everything starts with mind, it makes sense for us to begin to notice that we are not personally making this mind's attention move. It's doing it on its own. And when it does, it stops eventually. But by noticing this, we're beginning to notice anatta. This is interesting. Mm-hmm. We're beginning to notice the impersonal nature of what's mm-hmm. happening. Mm-hmm. And that's the beginning of uncovering the three characteristics as part of this. And it's not like the only key subject that there is, because if we go a little further as we go along here, we begin to see that if we're doing the practice we're going to be talking about, we're going to uncover the three characteristics completely, along with human cognition, along with the Four Noble Truths. So this can all happen naturally.
All right, mm-hmm. So how can we really make this happen? As in, how can we really understand the three characteristics of existence the way you've mentioned?
Well, if you're talking about the three characteristics of existence, let's look at what they are. They're basically anicca, meaning the impermanence of everything, and dukkha, which is the suffering itself. And then anatta is funny. When I was teaching, beginning to really study this in the beginning, I went to the teacher once and I said, well, this is anicca and it's impermanence, and that means change. And we human beings, we don't like change, do we? If something's really nice, we want it to stay that way. And if something is bad, we want to force it to change. We're not too good at accepting the flow of life. Mm-hmm. And this is why we suffer. So this is the core thing, this change. The unsatisfactoriness is the term that they like to use. And the suffering is the tension and the tightness that's caused by this, and all of the other pains that happen in the body as a result of the tension and the stress that builds up in us from wanting to make things the way we want them to be, okay? The anatta, however, is the escape. It's not part of the other two, you see. It's actually the answer. Mm-hmm. So I was fascinated that the three pieces, the anicca, dukkha, anatta, would be sitting there, and they, two of them are having to do with all the suffering, but the other one is the way out, mm-hmm. you see. So what does anatta really mean? We're going to detour here for just a mm-hmm. second, but you have atta and anatta. One of the problems in Buddhism is the translation of self and no self. And this is where we get into conflict with Western psychology, because they protect ego, and they think that when Buddhism is talking about self and no self, it's talking about threatening the ego. Mm-hmm. But this is very, very far from the truth if we're teaching Buddhism the right way. Because actually, atta is the idea of the self. It's delusion, the idea that everything I see, I hear, I taste, I touch, mm-hmm. or I experience in the sensations of the body or in the mind, they're all actually me, okay? And then this is wrong. This mm-hmm. is a wrong view. the correct view is this is not me, this is not mine, this is not myself. This is actually a function that's connected with the body. So what was going on about self and no self was, if I believe everything is me in that way, then I begin to blame myself for everything. Yes. Okay?
That happens.
Right. Yeah. But your eye just sees color and form and goes through this process of sight, and the ear just hears sound and goes through the process of hearing sound, okay? Mm-hmm. And which is part of a body function.
Of course.
So it isn't my function, it's a body function. Mm-hmm. So I always tell my students, you can call me in the morning if you can wake up and tell me that before you opened your eye and you began to see, you decided what your eye was going to see. And nobody ever calls.
Nobody ever calls,
right?
All right, so I think that's really a good way of looking at things, trying to at least see how we can look at things in its true aspect, like what Reverend Kema mentioned. So getting back into the topic we've been discussing about the precepts, I'd like to ask you, why don't we elaborate on the aspect as to how we can really make the precepts work, as in really practice it in our day-to-day life?
The first thing we have to do is really remember them, mm-hmm. Okay? Remember why am I asking you to try to do this? And I'm not telling you, you know, Budhima, do this.
Yes.
Okay. But as a guide, I'm telling you the Buddha tried this for 45 years. He's saying this is tested. This works for human beings. Why don't you try them? Mm-hmm. This is the easy way in life. So let's look at it in the way we looked at it with the young people when I was faced with that. But let's look at this. Let's look at an automobile. And take an analogy.
That would be an interesting example.
Okay, so let's look at an automobile and understand how the precepts actually mm-hmm. work. What they're really for? Are they? Is it somebody bossing you around about morality, or mm-hmm. is it actually something practical?
Yes.
So why don't you tell me what your favorite car is like?
A Lamborghini.
A Lamborghini. She wants a Lamborghini. I love it. Okay, so let's suppose that you bought a Lamborghini mm-hmm. or someone gave you a Lamborghini, and yes. you were told that the factory says there's 5 fluids in this car, mm-hmm. and if you have the fluids in the proper level in the car, everything's going to work all right. Mm-hmm. So you probably have in the car, you have gas and you have oil, you mm-hmm. have to have steering fluid, you have to have brake fluid, and you have to have transmission fluid. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, you say to me, well, I'm going to drive to Kandy, okay? If you're going to drive to Kandy, have you checked your brake fluid? What if you don't have any brake fluid in the car?
Are you going to just stop and I wouldn't be able to move.
You're not going to get there, right? Okay. So what about if you were going to go on a really long trip and you checked the engine, but there wasn't the proper level mm-hmm. of transmission fluid?
Still, I wouldn't be able to move.
Right. So what's happening to you is that you're telling me that if the fluids aren't at the right level in the car, mm-hmm. that this Lamborghini is not going to perform
the way I prefer it.
The way you prefer it and the way the factory said the car was going to operate, right? So what the Buddha was actually just doing here, he was not a dictatorial guru. He was not saying, this is what we do.
Yes.
He was saying instead, why don't you come and why don't you question everything that I have to say? Why don't you test everything that I have to say? And he created a new way of teaching,
yes.
you see. Mm-hmm. And he said, these precepts work because they are the operational manual for a human being. Just the way the 5 fluids in the car worked because you had them in the correct position. This is the way the human being is going to work. So he said, basically, it's interesting because he never even said to them, you should believe everything I said. He never said it once. Mm-hmm. And in one conversation to, I think it was Ananda, he makes the statement, they shouldn't even believe me. Mm-hmm. That's really something. So what he does is he invents a new approach called knowledge and vision, which is a predecessor for knowledge and wisdom.
Of course, when you actually talk about knowledge and vision, I'd like to ask you, Reverend Kema, knowledge, people do gain a lot from the texts and the books and all that. But the problem is whether they do really have the experiential knowledge, the so-called wisdom that we speak right. about, which is what is important. Let's elaborate on this aspect.
So what we have to do, we have to start and say, what does knowledge and vision mm-hmm. really mean?
Yes.
So knowledge and vision means knowing by seeing.
Mm-hmm.
So now what we have to say to the Buddha is, how am I going to know and see what you're teaching me precisely? And then what he's saying is, okay, I'll give you a gradual teaching, a gradual practice, there'll be a gradual set of learning. There's no secret teachings here. I'm giving you everything. And he makes a point before he dies of making sure Ananda understands, I have held back nothing that you need mm-hmm. in this lifetime to reach Nibbana, mm-hmm. to experience the jhanas, all of the stages, and to reach Nibbana. And this knowledge and vision, you can see it through the meditation that I'm teaching you. Mm-hmm. So the meditation becomes
a tool.
That's right. It becomes his instrument. I like to design pictures and try to put all the pieces together. Americans are like that. We like all puzzles, you know. So I was drawing, and one of the things that I was trying to show was like a microscopic slide,
okay,
which has the Four Noble Truths around the outside. You know, the Four Noble Truths are around it. In the center, there's a slide for a microscope. And when you look in,
okay.
you start to see the three characteristics. And inside of that, you see the spinning wheel.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get more power and deeper in your meditation, you begin to see that you can actually watch what's called human cognition. And then inside that, you begin to see, wow, we can go all the way through and let go of everything and see what's left.
That's amazing, Reverend Kema. I would like to also ask you, what is the primary part of teaching, which is the most valuable part that is required for the people in the society today, when you talk about the path that really Lord Buddha has shown us?
I think I have to say that, you know, I was, before I was a nun, I was a professional placement counselor. Mm-hmm. So I was involved in employment and everything.
All right.
And involved in that, I saw a lot of what was going on in the workplace, in corporations and in different companies. What happened with people that were working as teams, but things weren't working out very well, how they didn't get along and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And the kind of things that happen in the workplace that cause productivity and production to go down, mm-hmm. it always interested me. And then here we are with Buddhism, and it's 2,500 years old, and one of the most priceless things that we have is we have an answer for personal management of stress and personal management of tension in the workplace and management for low-level depression
mm-hmm.
and management for handling grief and handling stressful home situations, things like this. So we have this personal management system that can be taught, and the Buddha was explaining to us what you need in order to understand this is you need to look very closely at the suffering. How does it originate?
Mm-hmm.
How does it disappear?
Mm-hmm.
How do we become personally involved in it and it gets stronger? And when we get personally involved with it, why is that such a danger in
mm-hmm.
that? And it's because it takes you away from the present time. And how can we escape this during our lives? So
mm-hmm.
that's where we go back to the 60 million people and we say, what were they learning in day-to-day life? What was the farmer, the merchant, and the clerk and
mm-hmm.
all the different people in society getting that they could actually use that was changing their life from the Buddhist teaching? And as I said, it was meditation. So,
of course. And when you really take me through this track, Reverend Kema, would now like to put on this question to you. Where can we really start? Because a long journey starts with a single step.
You just did.
All
you
right.
just smiled.
All right, so smiling is
so
how we
smiling
can start.
Is How does the mind feel when you smile?
You feel more comfortable, you feel more peaceful within yourself.
Your mind is lighter. Mm-hmm. Your ability to concentrate on whatever you're doing becomes sharper. Mm-hmm. Your awareness wakes up. But when we're tight, we're really, really tight, and our mind is locked in tension, in heavy concentration, we're not able to come up with innovation. We are not able to come up with new ideas. We are not able to be progressive because we're locked in a tension situation. Mm-hmm. So what we want to do is we want to find something that is like when you smile. Each time you lighten the smile and sharpen the awareness, it helps to bring up your loving kindness. And some people would say the Buddha nature comes out. They would say that because the inner nature of the person has an inherent space inside that was natural when you were young. And the older we get, the further away we move from actually being able to just spontaneously mm-hmm. forgive someone or use compassion with somebody or use the loving kindness to help mm-hmm. people.
Reverend Kema, when you mentioned this, actually, this is something that lacks in the society. People really do not know how mm-hmm. to smile, I would put it that way. Or people do not really do this because they don't know the benefits that they can really gain by making a start to really practice mm-hmm. the so-called mm-hmm. Dhamma. Yeah. So how can you really pass on this message to the people?
One of the things that's questioned sometimes in Buddhism, and I ran into it about a year and a half back, mm-hmm. was you all are talking about smiling, but where does it say that the monks are supposed to smile? So everybody was questioning this. So I challenge you first to go to, I think it's Majjhima Nikaya number 149. And if you go there, there is a verse, a section in that sutta that explains the story of King Pasenadi mm-hmm. and the monks. Mm-hmm. And King Pasenadi had a pleasure garden in his kingdom. Yes. And you know that the monks went to these pleasure gardens yes. and the kings let them stay there for the rains retreat. And he was considering giving the pleasure garden to the Buddha and the monks. So he and some of his people, they went there to look at the garden and they saw the other ascetics that were dirty and smelly and looked really angry and really serious-minded, you know, and really pushing in their practice. And he said, this is not a very good thing. But then he went around the other side of the pleasure garden and he saw the Buddhist monks. Mm-hmm. And the Buddhist monks were sitting in contemplation with a little smile on their face. And when they got up to walk, they were smiling. Mm-hmm. And whenever they were dealing with each other, they were smiling again. And so this smile existed. It was actually there. That's not the only place we find it. But what happened was he went back to the Buddha. He explained what happened. And he said, I'm going to give you the pleasure garden because I think it would be wonderful for people to come and to see these happy monks. Mm-hmm. It would make them feel good. And so that's what he did. He gave it to the Buddha, and that's why. So one of the things we... the people, when they're practicing, they need to start smiling and just accepting things the way they actually are. This is part of the goal.
That's a good point.
Yeah, this is a big goal of this behavioral modification, mm-hmm. is to learn to accept things as they actually are, not to fight with the truth, not to try to change the truth, not to try to make it be what I want it to be, but to look at it and say, this is essentially what's happening now. Okay, I'm going to deal with what happened, you know?
Yes.
So we face this every day. I mean, even today, I came in with my computer and it didn't work and I'm using your computer. Okay. So even, yes. you know, this is the truth. So we just say, okay, fine. We just sort of, we call it roll with the punches, go with the flow. We learn to do this, and it's hard sometimes.
It's hard to expect the unexpected sometimes, and this is where the problems arise in the lives of the people.
We have to change our outlook mm-hmm. and say, it's hard to accept the unexpected, but the unexpected is in the flow, it's in the river. Mm-hmm. If you were ever canoeing or using a boat on a river,
there's logs in the river and all kinds of things in the river, and you go around the corner and you don't know, and there's rapids and there's rocks. So we just go with the flow and we try to see what happens next. And we face it by accepting it as essentially what it is, not getting involved, not getting upset with what is unessential about it, which is the imagination, the stories, and everything on top of it. We try to look at just what it is, and we remember something. Mm-hmm. We remember something. Anicca. We remember that.
The first characteristic of existence.
That's right. Mm-hmm. But I always thought it was a bad thing, and now I'm seeing it's a good thing, because we just accept that it's there, but it's going to go away. Yeah.
That's amazing. And this is how we can really step into this path, like Reverend Kema has mentioned. So I'd like to ask you finally, how can we really put this practice into work and make sure it really happens? Like you've shown the path. All right, so this is how you get into the path. But how can the practice be made to work?
I think part of the issue for a lot of the practices that have been attempted in probably the past 200 or 300 years have been the attempt to try to make them work. Just that statement. I have to try to make something happen. And the fun part about the practice is getting a person to understand they just need to let go and see what happens when we aren't trying to make something happen. You know, one person asked me once what we're really doing when we are doing the practice. And I said to them, you know, I had to think for a second. I said, well, we're trying to experience an experience of no experience. Mm-hmm. That's what we're doing.
Yes.
We're trying to get out of the way and take a look at what actually the human being is composed of and what happens to them when they let go and they start to empty out all the tension, all the tightness, and they smile and come back to what they're doing. Mm-hmm. You see? So I think this is really important. We don't have to make it happen. But in our society, what we strongly believe is if I don't have control, everything's going to go wrong. I have to have control.
That's the most important.
I have to steer. Mm-hmm. But it's a false idea. It's not real. Mm-hmm. Because what happened is if you let... The Buddha was very interesting because the monk comes to him and says, you know, I'm here because I've lost control. I need to get control. Please show me the meditation. I want to calm down and get control again. Mm-hmm. And the Buddha sits there and he says, well, here's the deal. Mm-hmm. If you let go of all control and you follow the meditation and watch how things actually work, you will be able to understand how everything works. And in that way, because you know the truth of how everything works now, you will become in control, but not through force. You see, remember we talked about the visitors, the hindrances.
Yes.
And the hindrances, they bother you, okay? Now, when you look in the text, it's interesting because the commentarial work adopted one part of the text and doesn't talk about the other part of the text. Mm-hmm. So the commentary, what it did was the commentary adopted the idea of these hindrances come, it's important that we destroy them, annihilate them, eradicate them, make them stop and oppress them, okay? But in the text, if we look, there's another set of verbs. Mm-hmm. Let's abandon them, relinquish them, let them go and let them be. Why? Because of anicca. Because they're just going to go away if we don't feed them our personal attention.
That's how we need to see things in its true aspect.
Right. So you see it in its true aspect, understanding how the hindrances work, all of a sudden we don't have to work so hard. Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much, Reverend Kema, for coming in for our discussion today. And it was amazing and it was really inspiring to listen to you. And thank you very much once again. And we hope to see you next time. Sabbe Satta Bhavantu Sukhitatta. May all beings be well and happy.
Sama Sambuddhi Sarana.